So we don't get there, and then there's one being, you know, well, what about this, what about that?
We get bills the night before we have to.
You're done. Now, there's, you know, your incidentals, like any hotel.
And that's fine.
So, it's, you know, plenty of room that you can save.
What will happen is whenever you get on board the ship, you'll, or actually before that, you'll give them a credit card, and then they will give you a basically what's called a sign and sale card that you'll use. You won't use any cash on board or any credit cards on board, you'll use a sign and sale card. And then at the end of the trip, then what will happen is your a statement will be.
We'll resolve it then.
Yeah.
All right.
It's like Disney, you know.
And really the only thing it would be pretty much drinks, or if you've got you know, some other, like a, something out of a spa or something like that, but outside of that.
Well, that's a good question. We'll have a Q&A. That's why when you got here tonight, stuff we have to go over that went and the university requires us to have a mandatory. And then we'll, of course, be on the ship quite a bit.
Does this count toward our 30 hours?
Effectively, yes.
I didn't know the answer to that. Good answer. Doesn't matter.
Thank you.
We don't charge it. We don't charge it.
Technically, it's 32 hours of contact. So,
is it?
Yeah.
You know, the new rules on overtime with the federal government put in last 6 months ago, a year ago. So you have to start paying us overtime if we go over 30 hours. Did that affect you guys too? Do you have some problems with that? We have all kinds of issues with staff people that we had to put all different kinds of ways of getting. Some had it on the clock that had never been on the clock before. Did the track phone go through that?
No, we did that a couple of years ago.
They're doing it now. They're doing a lot of instruction.
I think the rules came out 2 years ago.
They gave a lot of people raises.
Well, we, and then, for the university, some of our people were not within that threshold. Like, you're within $1,000 of that, they automatically gave the raise. If you weren't, they didn't. Well, that made a guy who didn't really have it. So we're trying to work through all that. It's all part of the deal. We'll give them 5 minutes.
Yeah.
This is a good exercise because the ship doesn't. At 6 o'clock, the ship's in the sick, it's gone. At 4:30, they're not waiting. So go ahead and put your little thing on so we'll start with our names, if you don't mind. You're going to be wearing this in our meetings and in town. We want to be able to identify ourselves. And, yeah, right.
Is there a SIM card in there?
For you, we have some of you guys. We have those little things in your ankles we put on. But that way, because you're going to be using business and all that, and they don't know who you are, but you have your building. You want to wait the 5 minutes?
It's up to you.
Anybody that you're aware of that is coming that's not here?
Several, but this is when we start, and I've got the recording, we'll be posting online.
All right, that's it. Okay.
Well, I'll let you go ahead and you can get your word.
All right, so as you all know, this is the first cruise trip. The university's taken trips before, but this is the first organized cruise trip to Cuba. There was a trip to Cuba a number of years ago. Actually, your brother went on. What's that? Only a
day.
So,
three cruise trips.
Three? Oh, wow. Okay. So, this is Sylvia Orta, Dr. Orta.
Nice meeting you.
And some of you have met her last the first meeting, and she will be coming with us. She is Cuban, from Cuba, and lives in this country, teaches at our education school. And then you all know Fred Forgy. I don't know if my students know Fred, but he runs our real estate department, Dr. Forgy.
One who sends you all the emails.
Yeah, that's right. I'm Tom Tirek. Along on our trip, we're going to have President Hinder and his wife, Anna. And in August, I saw President Hinder at some function. We go to a bunch of meetings. And he said, "What's new with entrepreneurship?" I said, "Well, we're going to put together a trip to Cuba. I'm going." And he's a really cool guy. George was a city manager of Fort Lauderdale when I met him the first time many, many years ago. And then he came on as the number two guy when Ray Ferrero was the president. And then when Ray retired, he became the CEO and president. So he's done a great job. He's a very likable guy and loves to be around students. That's where he gets his energy. He's one of these 7-day-a-week seven out of the week. He's working all the time. Loves the school, so he'll get a kick out of it. Next line reads, expect the unexpected. You know, we're going to a country that is still communist. And Sylvia, feel free. Alejandro, feel free. Alejandro is going to start school. You're starting? You've already started school? Or starting
no.
school? When are you going to do that?
Probably next year.
Next year. And he has just came to this country August?
Yeah, 9 months ago.
9 months ago. Okay, I'm sorry. I got this all wrong.
Forever.
But he's here to help us with your questions. And tell us a little about what's going on there. So toward the end, you'll see that Alejandro and Sylvia have some time to talk to you guys. And so anything you want to know about what's happening there, he's the guy. We're really glad you're here. And so let me tell you first off that Sylvia, we will probably, once we get on the boat, we'll all go by first names. Is that okay with you, Sylvia, too? And we're pretty
makes me younger.
Okay about it. Makes me younger. I'll do anything. So the dean and I were in Cuba negotiating with the University of Havana, which is a beautiful facility, building, and very, very nice people. Sylvia, we met with five administrators, and Sylvia is a good friend of at least one, but they all knew you, so you knew them all, right? Okay, well, one in particular, and Norma came to our school. We met with her first. The dean and I went down there on kind of an advanced trip, and we went both to the university and to the U.S. Embassy. And the plan was that Sylvia would, and I say negotiate, but would organize the trip with Norma, one of the administrators from the school. And then by the time we had this meeting, we'd have this all nailed down. It's not nailed down. So about halfway through this, Sylvia gets an email from Norma and says, the Cuban government will be handling this. We're not supposed to be dealing directly with you. She had the same problem I had with our dean today, right? And she said, so please go through your cruise ship, and then the cruise ship will contact the government will contact us, and it'll get back to you. So, okay, so we're doing this. And then Sylvia was assured just yesterday by Norma that, because I've been a little bit relieved, you know, how are we doing? And she said, no, not to worry, this is all gonna happen. But if it doesn't, that's okay too, because we have a backup plan. The backup plan, the original plan you're looking at, this itinerary is there, is that we would spend the mornings at a university and we'll spend the afternoons at some businesses. And that can have lunch, hopefully, on the campus if they have a cafeteria, which I would assume they do. And then, you know, go back to the ship. In Santiago, we're just in those towns for a short period of time. Havana, yeah, we had 2 days. Well, if all else fails, our backup plan is what we're doing on Saturday in Havana, and that is we're going to send you in teams with a list of questions to interview companies. And we'll have in each taxi will be a Spanish speaker. We have enough to go around, fortunately, thank goodness, because except for Sylvia, Fred and I are very limited. And I always saw my bucket list of fixed, so it's not fixed yet. And we'll actually be kind of a contest. And we're going to have prizes and stuff. But you guys are going to go meet people and have a list of questions. We sent you that prophet. I don't know if you had a chance to look at it. But that's a TV show on CNBC. And they actually went to Cuba, did one night there. It's kind of based on that, except we've been doing these entrepreneur interviews in our courses for years. So we have lots of data. And you guys are going to go out and get Cuban data for us. And then we're going to write this stuff up. And then we're going to compare what entrepreneur problems are there in Cuba compared to what we have in this country. And it should be kind of a neat paper, so you're going to all be involved in that. But it'll be kind of fun, too, because imagine yourself in a taxi cab. The drivers speak English, but you'll have a Spanish speaker with you. And you'll have a sector of the city you'll be assigned to. And you're going to be knocking on doors. We don't have any free arrangements here. And then try to work that out. Now, if all goes well with the government, then we actually have business we're going to visit. But even in those towns, we're trying to work it out where maybe half of us go to one company, half to another, and we still have time to do this little running around, doing interviews. And I think you'll find that people in Cuba are just really friendly, and they're kind of glad you're there. And then while you're at their business, we're going to give you some spending money to buy something. You can't leave there without spending money with that whatever that business is, unless you're going to buy a motorcycle or something, a pastry or whatever they're selling, or do something. All right, so that's the other, what else we got going? Oh, so, and we're on an island. And I don't mean, is anybody friendly? I spent a lot of time in the Bahamas, And on island, throughout the world, in islands, culturally, not just Cuban or Bahamian, but anywhere on island, you know, it's a much slower pace. And you have to do a mindset before you leave. And the mindset's half speed. And it's not that they're any, you know, IQ-wise any different than us. It's what happens is that today and tomorrow and yesterday are all very much the same. And you Americans are in a big rush. We don't get it. So wherever I travel in the world, even Asia, or if I go to the Gulf, I try to get myself on the airplane into this mindset that everything's half speed. If you get there, you're not going to get frustrated. If you don't get your head around that, you are going to get a little frustrated. And I was on a trip, the dean and I latched on to do the advanced work, and there were 40 people from New York City. And nobody gave this lecture. And they were miserable. And we had a ball. And they were complaining about this. And you just go for the phone. And you're going to love it. I mean, this is a really, really neat place to visit.
I believe that's part of the experience.
Yeah.
People that you have heard about, probably being with people like that, but that's part of the real experience.
And you're going to love the people. They're just great people. We've had some just wonderful people the last trip. And it could be our taxi driver who might be a medical doctor because they can earn tip money at, you know, because their salaries are very low. So it's going to be really going to be a lot of fun. We got work to do. We want to learn something. But we want to have a lot of fun, too. That's part of it. What about leaving out, Fred? Anything on that?
So of course
is that the cultural thing? Of course, any questions? Okay. The next thing is donations. We're going to find out, and I think some of you weren't here yet, but I have a contact. My former general manager's wife grew up with who's now the bishop in Santiago for the Catholic Church. And there are shortages in Cuba. You know this. And I mean, some dramatic shortages. So we'll want you to bring some, we'll find out what that is. I want you to bring some things with you that you can give to these people. We'll do it through the church. We don't want to give it to the government. We want to, because we don't know where it's going to end up. We want the church to get it.
That's good.
And whether you're Jewish or Catholic or Protestant, it doesn't matter, but we have a contact within the church. We know that we can trust our contacts to do the right thing with them. So these are probably going to be pharmaceutical products. And, you know, you do a Walmart run or something, but it's going to be Advil and everything that we need that they have a hard time getting, that we have easy to get to, they have a hard time getting to, we want to bring down. So we're going to ask you to bring a little duffel bag. That'll be very expensive, and you're going to leave that too. And we're just going to give the bag full of the goods to the church or whoever that, you know, whatever. But I'll have a list. I didn't want to tell you tonight just to go shopping. I want to see what their needs are. God, don't bring the wrong thing. It could be we're going to bring some supplies for some of the schools. We just don't know what the needs are. We're working on that right now, trying to work that out. All right. So plan on that. And we're not talking about spending a ton of money, but if you can spend 20 or 30 bucks and fill a bag full of good stuff for these people, it could be cold medicine, it could be baby Tylenol. What am I leaving out? I know we packed a bag last time. You had vitamins?
Vitamins, also
protein
soap.
Powder?
Soap.
Basic thing. Think about shampoo. Just basic classic. They run out of stuff there. They can't get it. So it's expensive. So we'll ask you to do that. And the last time we went on, Sylvia and I went together on this trip 7 years ago, the medical school helped us with lots of supplies too. So you may know somebody in the pharmaceutical business, like a pharmaceutical rep, and they get you maybe samples. So we got to be careful that prescription.
Expiration days
and prescriptions we have to worry about. We should worry about expiration days. But yeah. Okay. All right. So that's the donation part. Okay. So number four. The dean and I were at the U.S. Embassy, and we said, just by chance, what happens if we have a student that would have a problem and get in trouble there? What's the solution? And the answer was, there's none. So, I mean, we want you to have a good time, but we really got to be, and I know you guys are adults, we really got to be careful here. Drugs are a big issue there, and there's no tolerance. And if you were, you know, met some people, and you're kind of smoked some marijuana, you got caught, go to jail, it's done. We're out of the picture. And the embassy has fixers, but the ship's going to leave without you, is my contact. And that's not going to go well with your family. So I don't want to make this too dramatic, but there is no tolerance on drugs, and you just have to, you know, use common sense. You guys all saw what happened in Brazil in the Olympics where people got stupid and they got drunk. We can't have that. And the fact that the president's on the trip with us would be a career decision for Fred. So, just whether you care or not, but seriously, as our adults, but just be aware that we're going to a country, this is new for the country, relatively new, that for the American tourists, not for the Canadian and European tourists, but it's new for them, and our embassy is very concerned that, that we're real ambassadors, because they want to make this work. So we thought the ship originally went to Havana first, and now this time, it's going to Havana last, and we found out, we asked why, Fred asked why.
And the reason why is, the tourists want to be in Havana Friday night and Saturday, they were in Havana, and they were ending up in some smaller town, so they reversed the schedule. So originally, we were going to go to the embassy first. So the one thing that we have got worked out is that we will do a U.S. briefing, a briefing at the Havana, U.S. Embassy in Havana. And that's very impressive, and I think they're really going to, that's one of those kind of lifelong memory things. And they're going to brief us on what's going on in the economy, where this whole change is going. And of course, with the presidential election, there's concerns about how that all works too. But he doesn't get into office till January 20th, so we're fine. And there was talk, a lot of talk in the campaign about changing this whole program, but it's not that effective. Okay. If I do, we don't think it will. Okay, punctuality. You know, when you're on a group, there's nothing worse than waiting on a bus for somebody. So Fred and I made an executive decision, the bus is not going to wait for you. So when it's time to be there, you know, you got to be on the bus, or we'll see if that's going to shift. Because we don't want the whole group to be waiting. And nobody loves getting on and off buses as part of the deal. It's how we get around. But the bus is really in the morning, university, the afternoon, to visit some businesses. All right? The ship certainly won't wait for you. Let's see. Medicines. Okay, so now you're going to a foreign country. You guys have probably traveled abroad before. But, I mean, stuff happens, and you can get stuck somewhere. And we don't anticipate this. It's never happened on this cruise. But let's just say for some reason the ship doesn't leave on Saturday or Sunday we're coming back. Then be sure whatever medications you have to take, you bring extras, and bring a week extra. I'm not anticipating anything like that, but bring a week extra of medication. If you wear glasses, make sure you have spare glasses. Anything you need that you can get here easy, we can't get there. You have to assume we can't get there. All right. And that's something else in your medicine kit. You might bring some, in your donation kit, you might bring some reading glasses. You know, Walmart has this 3 for $20 deal, the different reading glasses. Those are kind of things that are tough for those people to get. So that's something that I brought down last time. That was, you know, quite popular. Copy a passport. Everybody probably knows this again. I took over it, but make a copy of your passport and put it in whatever, you know, in one or two places, so in case you should lose it, you know, by chance. I think what happens on the ship, they take it, right? They keep it? No, you get it back?
You keep it.
You keep it? Okay, so that's something we can't replace. Even though there's an embassy in Havana, it's going to be really difficult. So just keep copies of it. And then, you know, if something happens. But do they have safes in the rooms?
Absolutely.
Okay, so that's something you're going to lock up as soon as you get there. Okay. This is my first cruise, so I have no idea. Fred took this cruise in the summer, so this is my first time doing this.
But you will need the passports whenever you get off the ship. So.
They take it with them?
Yep, you need to go through customs.
Not each city, just the first
time?
Yeah,
each city.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
You're talking about the Cuban passport.
We're talking about your U.S. passport.
So
you get a visa.
Thank you.
From Cuba.
All right, so we got. So I guess we'll carry it around town.
Yes.
Okay, I didn't know that. If you want to change money, I can assure you, you have to have it. Okay, so you can't ever change money. Now, our plan, go ahead.
Question about the transfer of money. Do they have Western Union or something like that where I could get the money transferred over there rather than...
Take it with you.
Take it with you.
Don't do that. You're going to pay a fortune to Western Union
and
to do it.
From experience from this most recent trip, the lines at a lot of the banks are ridiculously long to transfer money. What I'm planning on doing is at our first stop in Santiago de Cuba is there are only going to be a couple of exchange booths at that location, unlike Havana where there's like 20 or 30. And so this is one of the downsides of starting off here. You're going to have 700 people on the ship all trying to change money. So what I'm going to do is get off the ship, I'm going to obviously race down there, sprint to the thing, and try to change about maybe $5,000. And then...
You guys never seen Fred sprint, so we're all going to watch.
Trust me. And then I'll basically work as the exchange agent, I'm not going to make any profit off of it, but just that will be a lot simpler to do that instead of having everybody try to, you know, stand in line and waste like an hour and a half, 2 hours trying to change money.
Okay, so there's...
International, like I get my funds internationally rather than change it to the U.S. and then back to...
Well, here's my suggestion. If you can bring euros, that's what I bring. And the reason is this, there's two currencies in Cuba. There's a local currency, the CUC. Is that, wait, are we gonna write? Which one's the tourist, CUP?
CUC.
CUC is tourist. CUP is for peso, right? Yeah. Cuban peso. Okay, so the CUP is locals, and then there's a tourist currency that is, you know, the local currency, they buy things a lot cheaper, like toll roads and things like that, than we do. The CUC is dollar for dollar, but when you change US dollars, they charge a 10% penalty because it's US currency. And so if you have euros, they don't do that. So
or Canadian dollars.
Or Canadian dollars. But what I'll do is I'll go to the my bank 2 weeks ahead of time, and I will buy euros, and then I'll take euros down there. And you'll pay your bank around 5% to do that, which is a lot of money for, you know, but it's better than 10%. So I like euros. And euros are one for, well, the euro's down now, 106 last night, so it's going to be close to a little more than one for one. But I think euros are better.
And what I'll probably do is there'll be another email that I'll send out and say, okay, how much money do you want me to get for you? You know, and then I can just have a list and have everything pre-computed before we actually get there, and then that way I'll know pretty much how much I need to bring.
You won't need a lot of money because
yeah.
We don't have much time in the first two towns. In Havana, you know, we have overnight, so we'll talk about Havana Friday night.
About the only thing that you'll spend money on if you stop and you grab a beverage or you get, you know,
souvenirs.
Yeah, souvenirs, you know, but
great markets.
Yeah. But you're probably not going to spend a fortune.
Markets are negotiable. We don't want to be too tough on them if you don't have to pay list price. I don't pay list price when you're bringing it. All right.
So, one second before you move on, can we go to our own banks and
get
our
euros?
Money?
You no, can't get okay. Cuban dollars.
You can't get
no,
Cuban dollars.
No, not Cuban dollars.
Oh, euros.
Yes.
You go to your bank. They won't do it the same day. They'll say, how much do you want?
Yeah.
And then they'll order for you, and then I'll have it in 3 or 4 days.
But my point is.
Actually, you know, when I did it for Greece, I got it the same day from those part of.
Really?
Yeah, they switched it out.
Did you get a free credit? Your credit card with it?
No,
I'm just kidding.
I was already, because I did this last year when the whole thing was happening with Greece, and I went and got cash ahead of time. It was the same thing, and I pulled enough to cover the trip, and they exchanged it out the same exact day. If you have a relationship with the bank, it's just certain locations do it, so you have to go to the location that does international.
Okay. See, my little bank, my Northern Trust Bank branches, they just.
See, that the problem is you can't get the Cuban currency here in the U.S.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that's why you have to go to the exchange locations.
And your credit card doesn't work over there.
Right. So don't expect that you're going to be able to go to an ATM and pull out cash. Not going to work. So the point being is you probably need to bring whatever cash that you in American dollars, and then I will, like I said, I'll go get 5-10 grand or whatever I need to get and exchange it. And then I'll be able to disperse.
Yeah, you just said, hey, Fred wants U.S. dollars. Otherwise,
right.
You got to change it back. So if you're going to use the Fred ATM, then use U.S. dollars. But I will have some euros with me, and they'll take U.S. dollars. They love U.S. dollars. I mean, that's not a problem. But they'll charge a penalty when you do the official exchange. And you don't want to be exchanging money in the street. Just we don't want to do anything that is anywhere gray area. It's just not worth it because there's not that much to say, right? Other than you, the dollars aren't that much. Okay. Everybody's got the money thing? All right. Buddy system. We want nobody on the streets alone, ever. And that's any big city, right? So, you know, we'd rather have you in groups, minimum group is 2, and then rather have you in groups of 4 or 5, or as big as you want. But nobody wanders around by themselves, right? Because if anything happens, we need somebody to tell us. Your AT&T telephone will work. Very, very expensive. We're finding out before we leave whether you can roam, whether you should turn it off all the time.
Verizon also works.
What else? Verizon?
Verizon.
Now, let me ask you something. If the phone is on and I'm not using it, will I pay roaming charges in Cuba or just when I use my phone?
Turn off the data.
Yes.
That's what I do when I travel internationally.
Yeah. So, like you're going to Europe.
Yes.
Use the same kind of rules, but we want to be able to call you or text you in case of any kind of emergency. We don't expect anything. But we'll be able to get in touch with you. So we're going to have everybody's cell phone number. You have it now, right?
Yep.
Okay, and then just be aware that if you try to call home or send a picture home, don't do that. Send a picture home when you get home, because it's going to be very expensive.
And the same thing is true. Aboard the ship, you can purchase internet. That is the one thing that we did not include. It's pretty pricey. It's, I think, $120 for maybe an hour, something like that.
What?
Yeah,
$120?
It's ridiculous.
Wow.
Well, so what you're going to do is you're going to do your stuff in Word or whatever, and then you're going to upload.
In fact, I'll let you take over, Fred. This, we're right there now. Anyway, take work online, presentations. Oh, should I talk about the Friday night thing? And
yeah, we haven't talked about all that.
All right, let me skip over, because Fred's our blogging expert in how we're going to do the your assignments. Let's talk about dress. Sylvia, Fred and I have been discussing today. If we do get to go to the universities, which we're planning to have two lectures at each university in the morning, if we do get to go, should we be wearing slacks, long pants to the university, or can we wear shorts to the university?
I think so.
Long pants.
What do you
too.
Think, Alejandro?
No, it's not big deal.
Would the students be wearing shorts or long pants?
Yeah, yeah. Anything? Yeah, there's not a dress code in any Cuban university.
So do you think, as visitors, should we be in long pants for the university or not? Tell us what you think is the best.
It's up to you. I've seen a lot. I've seen my international groups coming in and even lectures in shorts.
Really?
It's not a big deal.
So, Fred, let's make a decision on the spot here. Are we okay with shorts? I'll wear shorts on the shift. You don't love me. But I'm a shorts and t-shirt kind of guy on the shift. But we don't want to wear any t-shirt. We wear anything to our meetings on the ship. Wear anything you want on the ship. We're talking about just strictly off the ship. What should we wear? And I think probably maybe a nicer, like a polo kind of shirt.
Yeah, just no t-shirts.
How about what do we make? Is that okay, everybody? Everybody's there with no t-shirts? And shorts are optional then? Just, you know what I would do here? And I mean, I don't know, just like say this. I would wear anything too short, you know, just want to make sure we're kind of representing the university. We have to be a little bit careful in the presence with us and all that stuff. So we have to be a little bit careful. I will probably wear a long pants to the university. Now, Friday night in Havana, we found out the University of Havana is very, very, made a point to be very, very proud of their culture. They have a wonderful opera, a wonderful ballet. And they kept talking about the ballet, and I wasn't kind of getting it. And so I made some notes. When we got the U.S. Embassy, I asked the commercial affairs officer we were dealing with, and I said, they kept talking about the ballet. What am I missing here? They said, oh, it's important because they don't think that we appreciate what they do, and that if you're invited to do that, then you need to do that. It only takes a couple hours. It's really, really good. A lot of these people are trained at the Bolshoi in Russia. So it's probably, I mean, I've not been to the Bolshoi, but they tell me that there's nothing mistakes like this. So we may ask you to join us. It would be very important to them that we learn their culture, and that we may Friday night end up at the ballet. With plenty of time to drink the rest of the night, but we may take the bus to the ballet. We just don't know yet. We haven't got that worked out yet. But if it's important to them, then it becomes important to me. Okay, we don't want to offend anybody. And the plan is they're going to come to see us, and then next year we want to go back. So that's a possibility on Friday night. So here's the reason I'm telling you this. So bring one, if you're close, bring one kind of nice outfit, not cocktail wear or anything, but kind of a, you know, like this kind of a routine, and short sleeve shirts, but kind of what's that, business casual? Just okay, business casual for one night. That may happen, may not happen. Otherwise, everything on the ship's totally casual, right?
Absolutely.
Okay. And I guess you can eat all day long if you want to, just drink all day long. There are dining rooms there, and there are buffet, and you can talk more about that because you've been on the ship. Okay, let's see. Okay, that's dress. Book reviews. Everybody's got their book. Yes. Okay. I think it's a pretty good little book.
Yeah.
And you understand how we're doing this? We're signing each room a chapter, and then you're going to come teach us about it, and then we'll have a little. How long we decide, about 10 minutes each? 7.5
basically
minutes?
For each group it'd be 15 minutes for the presentation and 15 minutes for Q&A.
So the two of you will be a team, and 7.5 minutes each, and then we'll do Q&A the last 15 minutes. And we're sailing all day Tuesday, so that's our big day of work on the ship. So we're gonna cover those chapters.
And Thursday.
Right. Two big sailing days.
Okay. So we have to present it to the class, basically.
Yes, you do.
Yep. And we'll talk a little bit more about that in terms of,
yeah.
You'll need to have your presentations done before you board the ship, because I will basically be collecting all of those presentations and uploading them on a computer, bringing a projector, all that sort of stuff, because we can't really assume that we're going to have everything that we need there. So like, and the presentations, the idea is to not just replicate what's in the book.
We've all read it.
Yeah, we've all read it. The idea is to sort of take that as your theme, and then do something extra, okay?
Outside research.
Yeah, whatever that is. It may be, actually, part of it could be maybe a short YouTube video that you found that was directly related to that. It could also be, you know, articles that potentially you found that, that deal with that particular topic. Pretty much just anything that kind of relates to that general theme.
So just a presentation, no paper, nothing.
Yeah. And these are not long. I mean, he's challenging. You've seen his book. It's not a big book. But it's full of great stuff. I think it's one of the better reads. And apparently, these guys do this for every country in the world. I wasn't aware of it. And the guy who wrote this is a Venezuelan. But it's, I think from my experience, it's really on target.
And then another aspect of this that we don't know whether the president's going to sit in on these presentations or not, but the expectation should be, from your perspective, that he probably will be sitting in on the presentations. So you need to do a great job with these, okay? Want to add anything to that?
Well, it's just that, you know, again, it's chapter short, do your research. This is for the entrepreneurship management student, this is part of your grade. And then you'll also, at the end of the trip, you have to turn in on your blog you talked about, you'll need to have a book review, and that's a paragraph that you're going to write for each chapter. Just one paragraph. And this is not a 40-page business plan. One paragraph for each chapter, that you know you read it. And then there's a list of questions we put here that at the end of your review, that we want you to tell us what these things are. There's 5 questions.
And this is due?
Before you get off the ship.
But we'll have.
Huh?
You want it on the blog?
You can. Is that the way we? That's
but there's
easy
no
way to do it. That's
internet. But there's no.
No. You can.
Or you can. You want to? You tell me.
Okay. Yeah. So, the way that this can work, the easiest way to do your blog is, hopefully most of you have been sending your blog addresses, so I know that you're getting on there and you're getting it done. What you can do is all the pictures you take, all the video that you take, all the things that you're writing up, you can do all of that in Word. Okay. Save it in Word, and then once we get internet access, then it's just a quick, you know, upload to the blog. Or upload, I'm sorry, to the, yeah, upload to the blog. Does that make sense?
When do we get internet access? You mean like
on the ship?
Right. Well, it probably, what I'm going to do is I'm going to buy probably a couple of hours worth of internet, and then I can allow you to upload it from my machine.
Okay. Another question regarding.
So bring a jump drive.
Regarding the chapters, I know like Bridget and I had like e-business. That was
right. Okay. So for you guys, specifically, what you're going to do is you're going to find any articles, any maybe short videos, anything that relates to kind of e-commerce, e-business happening in Cuba.
So it's not the book or
no.
The person.
You guys.
That's your base.
Yeah, no, but for those guys, they're not using the book.
Oh, I'm sorry. Special topics.
The individual
yep.
Presentation.
Yep.
Yeah.
But you're still going to do a book review.
Right.
And what you'll find when you go around an event, you'll see a crowd of people standing by a telephone pole near a restaurant or something. And that's a hotspot. You know, and I don't recommend, we don't know the security of those hotspots, so we don't recommend that you tie into those. They may be okay, I just don't know. But on the ship, we'll have a block of time to even upload. Okay. Everybody's got it? All right, so you can understand. You're going to, oh, sorry.
So for the presentation, we'll have internet for like videos and stuff. If we're
once again, no. For what you'll need to do is save all of that on the jump drive before you get on the ship.
For like a YouTube video, how will you be able to play it?
You should be able to save it.
You have to download it.
Yeah, you can download it and convert it.
Right.
It's
like MP4.
Okay, so the question was, how do they get the book review and the questions to us? And I said blog, I might have been the wrong way to say it. They can email to us.
Yeah, there's email to us.
Okay, so email them to Fred. Is that one place to do it? Or you got it. You don't want to. We just have to have one. Okay, before I let Sylvia and Alejandro speak with you, and you can ask them questions too, any questions about anything so far? Yes.
Sorry, I just got here late. So there's 2 main assignments, a book report and...
You and your cabin mate are going to do a presentation on the ship. And it's going to be a total of 30 minutes, but 7.5 minutes.
No. Yeah.
7.5 minutes each for presentation. You want to go outside your chapter and do some research and download it on your flash drive. And then we're going to have a discussion about what you're talking about. And Sylvia will be along there with us. And then you'll have to email us before the trip's out the book review. And you know, the book review, you don't have a paragraph for each chapter, but you've now been in Cuba for a week, and we want you to. You know, you add a little bit about what your experience was. And then that'll go to Fred or I, and that'll be great. There's five questions on here that are, you have the review of each chapter plus the five questions. Guys, this can't, this is for you entrepreneurship management students. This is not a ton of work, but we have to have coursework because you're getting course credit.
But where is the review?
Yours is going to be part of your...
Are you real estate?
Yeah, it's for them, it's going to be part of their e-portfolios.
You're reviewing the book.
And for the other, for the entrepreneurship management students, it's going to be actually a course.
Do you have a paragraph for each chapter?
That's important.
Yep.
This will be my one part.
Yeah, effectively.
So each chapter presentation is 15 minutes.
The presentation, the 15-minute discussion.
But it's not...
Let's just say 30 minutes.
Well, so...
The total is 30 minutes. 15 minutes of...
15 minutes for the general topic. Okay, let me make sure that I am absolutely 100% clear on this. You are not presenting the material in the book, okay? We have all read that, okay? That is not what you are presenting. What you will be presenting is supplementary material that you have found through your own investigation and research that relates to the general theme of that chapter. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Okay, so that could be, as I said, could be short, maybe YouTube videos, could be articles that you have found, news articles, journal articles, whatever those might be, and then you would be coming in and effectively being the subject matter expert for that particular theme. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay.
And I left something off. It's important to me anyways. It's not very, it's not part of the educational experience. From, for those who want to, purely optional, I'll bring my gold stars, just in case. There is some form of fitness from 8 to 9 a.m. on the ship. And I'm somebody who loves spinning classes. And you don't want to see me in yoga, I'll sit in the back of the room, but I'm not very good at that. But I think it's great. And so that's why we don't start till 9:30. So you're going to be on the ship eating a lot and drinking a lot. It's a good time to do 8 to 9. So not required, but I will be in that class from 8 to 9 each one. That's kind of my deal.
This is probably the biggest point of disagreement between myself and Professor Kuhn for a variety of reasons. But one is, you know, I wanted to, you know, start breakfast at 7 o'clock and start class at 8 o'clock, but, you know, you wanted to do the exercise. So.
Well, plus I said, well, you know, 7 o'clock in the morning, I'm pretty sure, I don't know. Anyway, we worked it out, so it's going to be 9:30.
One paragraph
for you,
but I think, you know, I'm not going to change your life on this trip. I'm going to give you a lifelong memory. But if you're not exercising regularly at your age now, when you get to my age, it gets really more. And so it's going to be a life thing, you know. So you might enjoy it. So at least one of the mornings, try it.
You're talking about the sailing dates, right? Tuesday, Thursday mornings?
So. Every morning. Well, I don't know. That's not true. Sailing dates. That you're correct.
What was wrong?
We're on the boat at 8 o'clock. Yeah, and Friday morning we're off the boat. But once, like in San Francisco, we don't get there till the afternoon, so we have time that morning. So I tell you the exact days. Monday morning. We get to that. We're in San Diego Tuesday morning. The exercise days. We get to Santiago Tuesday morning, right? So it's by Monday morning, Wednesday morning, and Thursday morning. You'll have the exercise classes, not recording, right? Monday, Wednesday, Thursday, is that right? Whatever. I'll be in exercise class, Monday, Wednesday, Thursday. Yeah?
So there is no block?
No, we're getting to that.
No what?
There is a block.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Okay. So there's two parts to this deal. There's the book, and there's the block. One's like a journal, and one is to learn about it before you get there. We want everybody reading this book before they get there, so you don't. Trying to avoid the ugly American regime. We want you to get there some knowledge of what you're going to see, some knowledge of the culture, so we kind of know, what's, kind of get an idea of what's going on before we get there. Let me tell you, it's just really a neat place. And I've only been to two cities close to Havana, but I've not been to Santiago, I've not been to San Pedro, and I have friends of mine that have. It's just, I think you're going to love, I mean, that's why you're on this thing, you're going to love this thing. This is neat. All right, what else? So, got that straight? There's two parts to this thing. There's a journal, and then there's a book review. Okay. I mean, that's it. There's no tests, there's no quizzes. It's just the two assignments. And the presentations. Let me tell you about presentation. Let me tell you why we're doing this.
One thing we learn about as teachers, as instructors, is, and the MSU is very good about this, they send us off to
conferences to learn more about teaching. Because when you get your doctorate, there's no classes in teaching for free. So here's what we learned. Our lecturers have about a 10% retention. When you read something like this book, retention is about 20%. When you present material to a class, it's 70%. Now this has been tested and tested and tested, and it's absolutely what goes on. So that's why we're having you involved in the presentation. We're not, we do this for a living, so it's no problem. We did it, but we want you to do it and do the research. And that's where you're going to have the real retention, is that one chapter you're zooming in on, you're really going to know about that stuff. And it was very important. Listen, the University of Havana is their main university. That university doesn't teach business courses. It's a social technology. They don't do business. But their feeling is, if you understand the culture, you can do business here. Well, that makes sense to me. They told us that. So that's what this is all about. We're going to have to learn about their culture, so someday we're going to do business there, we know what that's about. All right, anything else?
Let me just kind of go through and kind of expand on a couple of
okay.
things. And then, so let's just start with the itinerary here for a second, just to make sure everybody's sort of clear as to what's happening. On the first day, obviously getting there, the idea, please show up sometime between 2 to 3 in the afternoon on Sunday. Make sure you've got adequate time to get on board the ship. It will leave at 4:30. But we want to get everybody on board and make sure everybody's checked
in. It's like international flights. You wouldn't get to Miami Airport if you didn't have 2 hours to spare, right?
Yeah. And the nice thing is, once you're on the ship, you'll get to go to your room. You get to have maybe a drink or two. Everything, you know, will be great, okay? So it's not like you're going to be, you know, stuck with nothing to do. Okay. One of the things that the ship does is they have several different information sessions. Chances are the first one is at 7:30 p.m., called Cuba, It All Starts Now, and this is basically kind of the ship's sort of version of kind of an indoctrination into kind of Cuban culture and kind of telling you some of the do's and don'ts and other things to be sort of looking out for and being aware of.
And Fred, here's our problem. We don't have the schedule.
We don't have their schedule.
We ask for the schedule. They typically give you the schedule when you get on board, and we're saying, hey, we have a class. We have 37 people here. We need the schedule. So we're trying to work that out. We took the schedule that Fred had.
But it's the reverse cruise in the sense that it effectively went the opposite direction, so the days are a little bit off.
So we're guessing right now, so this is all subject to change. With notice, we'll give you notice, but it could be last minute. We won't know the next day's real schedule until the night before. That's why we'll be.
Okay. So starting on Monday, as we've already talked about, all the different presentations, and the thought process here, the reason why we did it this way, is specifically to get us through the book completely before we actually set foot, you know, in the country. So that was the whole reason to kind of push it all to that one day and kind of get it done and sort of get it over with. The thing to take note of, pretty much, you know, after we're done with class and if they are potentially going to have another destination talk, in this case about specifically Santiago de Cuba, but, you know, pretty much after that, you're completely on your own to do whatever you want to do, okay, in terms of you want to have dinner with the group or you want to just, you know, fly solo, whatever you want to do on board the ship, your call. The next day, Tuesday, it's pretty straightforward in terms of, as Tom's already mentioned, the university in the morning and then the city center in the afternoon to meet with businesses. And as he mentioned before some of you got here, it's going to play out one of two ways. The one way that we have tried to set up with the Cuban government is that they will effectively tell us specific businesses that we should go and meet with. If they fail to do that, our plan is to effectively have a scavenger hunt, okay? And by that, what we mean is we're going to break you up into groups of probably 4 or 5 to a group with at least one Spanish speaker within the group, and then we're going to send you out into different sectors within, and we'll have this all mapped out as to which sector of the city that you will basically be thrown into, and then you will effectively be competing against the other teams to effectively interview as many different small business operators as possible. You know, this could be some small restaurant, maybe a small bar, small bakery, whatever it may be, but the idea is to be able to interview all those folks, and we've got a list of questions that I did not provide you with that you would basically be asking. And so the kinds of questions would be, you know, how many employees do you have? Why did you start the business? How did you choose this particular type of business? How do you perceive your competition? How do you differentiate your business from the competition? How did you recruit your staff? How did you capitalize or pay for the business? In building your business, what would you have done differently and how? How has the business affected your family responsibilities? How does your spouse feel about the business? What is the biggest problem that you've had in the past 12 months? How did you handle it? And then finally, the most important piece of this is your evaluation of the business with respect to what recommendations would you make to improve the business?
Okay. We're not going to necessarily tell them that. We don't want to embarrass anybody here. You've got to be a little sensitive that there may be some questions they don't want to answer. If you're not a British student, you've done this in the U.S. We said earlier we're going to compare the two results. It's kind of interesting to see how this works out. This will be part of a research paper that the professors will be doing when we get back now. Because everybody's curious about what's going on in Cuba and how's it working. So that again, it's all part of that process, but you've got to be sensitive to if they're a little shy about answering, just go to the next one. And, you know, for instance, where'd you get the money to start the business? Tough question. We don't want to know how much. You know, that's not our, not, and it may have come from a cousin of Miami. They may not want to say that, you know. So you can say, you know, the way you phrase it, who's over the Spanish speaker in the group would be, do you mind telling us where you found the money to start the business?
But well, I believe that the documentary shows a lot about...
They were pretty open with it.
Yeah, the way they asked questions and how they responded, that's what you're going to find.
You all got the CNBC?
Yeah.
Pretty good.
And there's more than one that you can search on YouTube or CNN.
So this would also be information that you would contain within your blog. And so the one of the things that you would need to do is that at each stop, you would take a picture of potentially the person that you interviewed, as well as a picture of the storefront or whatever it is. And you could obviously combine both into one picture, but that would serve as evidence that you actually, you know, did
do it's the a contest. Stuff. It's like a fishing tournament. We want to see the fish.
Excuse me. Don't you think that might cause us to be a bit, I'll say, off-putting towards them if we're rushing to go from spot to spot?
Well, again, that's a very good question, and you should be aware of that. You know, the quality is more important than the quantity, really. There'll be probably a little prize for the best, the most, and a prize for the best. It won't just be for the most. And, if, you know, they may ask you, gee, what do you think? And you'll introduce yourselves as MBA and Master of Business, graduate students in business, and that you are with a university, and you'd like to ask some questions about their business because you want to compare them to how business is done in the U.S.
Going back to the documentary, they show a place, it's a artisan's place. You can find there 500 entrepreneurs.
Yeah, right across from our ship. Our ship, I think, docked right across the river from that, right?
You can even walk right there. You're going to find 500 people there trying to, am I correct, Amalie?
I've been to that market.
All kind of stuff. Like this lady that was selling soap, she makes the soap in a crock pot. But that's ingenuity, and that's what you're going to find. Taxi drivers, they are educated people. And
you may find it to be a medical doctor driving your taxi.
They
want to help you.
So, Haladar, which is the private, there's a lot. They don't stay open too long, some of them.
It's hard to keep a business open.
Because of getting supplies?
That's one thing, yeah.
Are there restrictions on the time they can be open?
No, but pretty much if you want to keep your business open, you're going to have to risk a lot to get your supplies. And eventually, like, the government's going to catch up on how do you get those supplies, and pretty much all the time you're going to do something illegal, and they're going to shut you. That
you may be buying your supplies on the black market.
So. Yeah.
And how many of on these smaller companies, how many will be licensed? There's 200, well, it's fine, there's 201 licenses, right? How many will be licensed?
Pretty much, right now, everyone needs to be licensed.
Okay.
Everyone needs to.
But the problem is where they're buying supplies. And the government would hope they'd buy it from the government stores.
The government doesn't give like an alternative for you to buy like a large amount of supplies. So if you have a restaurant, you know, like, I don't know, 200 boxes of chicken or whatever to, like, to cook your foot, but the government doesn't give you like a preferential price if you're gonna buy a lot.
I see, there's no discounts.
So you have to go to the store and buy it at the same price. And what people do is that they collect all those receipts, and that's why they show to the guy that goes and do like, when they go to check their papers and stuff, that's what they show, and they buy chicken on the black market.
And they go to a farmer directly.
Yeah.
So it's a very confusing system, it's very difficult. This is kind of what makes it so interesting. That's why we're taking you guys. This is where entrepreneurship's just started. You know, how cool is that?
I also believe that it would be interesting to contact the professor that was interviewed in the documentary, because he goes often to Cuba.
That's a great idea, sir.
And that's going to be, I'm going to Google him tomorrow and try to contact him. It's very interesting. That documentary is very, very eye-opening. You don't know.
Yeah, I watched it. They had it on CNBC this Tuesday.
The one thing that I really don't agree with that person, and I've never seen him before, is that he believes, at the end he says, that what is going to happen if the economy doesn't grow, that if that is going to kill the ingenuity. I can tell you, and I was living in Cuba for 40-something years, that would not happen. Because it's engraved in the blood and the brains of Cubans and many other countries. But
well, look at Cubans did in Miami. Look what they've accomplished in so few years. It's amazing.
I remember there was one morning that when the law, it was like 20-something years ago, probably more, that they allowed entrepreneurship, small enterprises. And it was in the morning, and the next day there was, hundreds of people selling stuff.
Wow.
I don't know if somebody leaked the information, but it was just like that. And they were inventing, ingenuity is there, and that's not going to be killed by any system or anything.
It's the very industrious, hardworking.
We're many tourists right now, and you saw that in the documentary also, so that brings more confusion, and I'm positive that the embassy is going to refer to that.
Oh,
yeah. Being careful, don't show many jewelries or...
That's a really good, I didn't say that, mm-hmm. Really, and any time you leave the country, it's not smart to take your jewelry with you, leave it at home in a safe, you don't need to wear it. And we don't want to show off either.
Mm-hmm.
Good point. Thanks, buddy.
All right. A couple of other things I just want to make sure that I mention. On Thursday, the topics that are listed here are not, obviously, as part of a book specifically. And so the individuals that are assigned to these particular topics, we can kind of talk about the expectation. But in general, what you're going to be doing is, once again, collecting information about these topics. And for the most part, focus on Havana, since that's where we're going to be, obviously, the day after those presentations. So things that you can identify related to those topics as it relates to Havana specifically. Okay? Does that make sense? All right. And then also, as I mentioned, if we end up doing kind of a scavenger hunt thing and we do break into groups, in order to avoid duplication of businesses, that is going to be the reason why that I will eventually, I'll give you maps and then ultimately break the cities into different sectors, and then you'll go out as a group and then collect the information. So
your taxi driver will be very helpful.
And that's a group of two?
No, it'll probably be a group of four or five, depending.
Did we get to choose?
The only, you can choose, but we've got to have one Spanish speaker in the group. That's the only requirement. Because obviously, otherwise, it could be problematic.
Okay. People get by.
I just out of curiosity, of the folks in here, how many of you are Spanish speakers? Okay, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and I know we've got a couple of others. So
we should be fine.
Okay. All right, and that's much for me. Yep.
Can I get clarification as to on the stop days, which are Tuesday, Wednesday, and Friday?
Yep.
Are we, so looking at Tuesday, you want us back on the ship by 5 o'clock? Does that mean we're gonna have any time at all to ourselves in Santiago?
No.
Okay, so that's, we're booked.
Pretty much each location, the only location you're really going to have, you know, substantial free time is gonna be in Havana.
Yeah, but think about this, Mike, you're gonna be wandering around the city talking to companies, and then, how many hours do we have in San Diego, 8 hours, something like that?
That's a lot, though.
So, I mean, the last hour, you guys said, hey, okay, let's go, I mean, we're not gonna be following you around, we want you to have a good time, but there's not a ton to see. There are some great historical sites in Santiago I read in the book about, you know, from the Spanish-American War and things like that. But they're out of town, they're, you know, it's a bus ride out to go see them. And Fred has been on the cruise-sponsored tours, and he wasn't knocked out by it. I think we're gonna have more fun. And we may end up on them, if everything falls apart with us, so we don't know. Whatever it is, and then we'll enjoy that too. But Havana's where you're gonna have one.
Any
Event's exciting. I mean, it's a beautiful city. And you can just, when you get there, you can picture how it was 50 years ago. You know, oh my gosh. You know. The Malecon, you're going to see all this stuff. And my favorite hotel over there is the Nacional, because I stayed there as a child. My dad did consulting work in Cuba. So that was our vacation, one of our vacation spots. So I was there. And what happens to when you go back is the buildings get smaller. Right? Because you're little, they're huge here.
So, just to make sure I summarize one more thing. Okay, go ahead.
Just on the presentation, just to point on the video, what is the video?
Okay, so within your presentation, once again, it's going to be information that you collect that's outside of the book. The book is just simply giving you the topic. So if you were to find, kind of like some of the videos that I've sent you, you find a video that's a perfect fit for that particular topic. We don't want like a 30-minute, you know, obviously video, but, you know, some sort of like 2-3-4, you know, minute video that you could potentially, you know, show that is direct and on point to that, then that could be part of your presentation. Not all of your presentation, but a part of your presentation.
Okay. And do you need some sort of physical submission, like a PowerPoint?
Yeah, no, what I'm going to need before you actually get on the ship is to have your jump drive, or you email me your presentation with what, you know, the video embedded using PowerPoint, and then what I will do is assemble all of those on my laptop so that we can just kind of blow through those during the presentations, so and we'll have to try to deal with all the technology issues of potentially trying to track it down some other way.
I've got a silly question. I've never been on a cruise. So you're taking 395, you go in the tunnel?
Yeah.
And go across, that takes you over, that tells you where. And how do you know where your cruise ship is?
We
have the smallest one. We won't have our time, but how do we know?
There will be a sign that will say specifically.
That's why they're cruising cheap, you take turns. Sorry.
Yeah, there will be a sign that will say.
Fathom this way,
yeah,
and this
exactly.
That way. Okay. So just, you know, be aware that Sunday all the ships depart. That's why we'd like to get you there at least a couple hours early.
I don't know if you address this or not. Is there a shuttle from here?
No. You're on your own from here to getting to Miami and back. And the reason, obviously, is, you know, just the whole thing of everybody living in different locations, and we just figured it would probably be easier for people to take Uber or you know, whatever you choose to do, carpool.
There's
that's fine.
There's a place to keep our cars over there, right?
Well, I'm sorry.
Like.
You could, but I
recommend
that. I can't remember what the price is per day, but it's kind of like the airport. You know, I can't remember, but I want to say it's like $12 a day.
So it's all inclusive except the transfer is getting you to the ship and getting home from the ship. Otherwise, everything else is taken.
Alcohol?
No. You can
free alcohol.
You can have all you want, but we're not going to pay for it. It's not sandals. I mean, your food and they have some beverages, but not the liquor.
Yeah, and even with the beverages, the only thing that's included, water, iced tea, juices, and that's it, okay? If you want, like, Coke, it's like $5, okay? If you want, you know, a mixed drink, probably $7 or $10, depending on what it is. Beer, probably like $7. So one thing that supposedly you can bring on a limited amount, you know, of beverages on your own, but, you know, that would be something, go ahead and contact Fathom on your own to find out specifically what.
We don't want to know about that.
Yeah, we don't want
to. But as far as anything other than, I mean, seriously, you know, the drug thing is a big issue, and this is zero tolerance.
Do you know if there's like a drug package?
Yeah, but it's one of those sorts of things that unless you're going to be drinking 16 drinks a day, it's really not cost effective.
Well, it might work.
Well, I might be going to the rum. Like rum, the most wonderful rum in the world is made in Cuba.
And my favorite, there's different brands, but my favorite is the Havana Club 7 Years. Sipping rum.
How much cash should we bring? And I don't know if you know this, do they accept Amex down there?
No credit cards.
Okay. You know, on board the ship, you can obviously, and they have an ATM on the ship, you know, for U.S. dollars. But as far as, you know, the amount of cash you should bring, I mean, it's just going to be depending on you know, what it is you plan on potentially purchasing. If you're going to bring back a case of rum and cigars and...
Now, they just changed the rule. You're allowed, it used to be, when I was there in April, you could bring back $100 of cigars and or rum. Now it's $400, as much rum as you want, right?
Pretty much.
Yeah.
Hardly wait. Okay. But I guess trying to answer your question, you're going to have, Havana is the only place that you'll probably have time to spend money in the street. So we're going to buy your lunch in San Juegos and then also Santiago and also Havana. So I can't imagine, you want a couple $100, but I can't imagine having a lot. You may want to buy art or, you know, I have grandchildren and I buy them little toys and bongo drums for my big one. And, you know, it's that kind of stuff. You bargain for that stuff. That just
he's going to buy cigars. And
cigars.
He's going to buy rum.
Yeah.
Yes, of course.
So, Sylvia, what do you have to add? Because we've been going on. What do you want to tell these guys that we have that we missed?
I don't know. It's exciting. You need to bring a huge bag with attitude. Because the attitude for learning, the attitude that you use every day, respect to each other. Because there is a lot of pride in the Cuban people. Even though they cannot be well dressed or they can speak English beautifully, there's a lot of pride. But that you see that every day. I mean, it's nothing unusual. But we are sensitive about that. We are very good people. There's bad people like in everywhere. But I mean, the bottom line is that we welcome foreigners. We don't discriminate anyone. I always say that we are blind, a colorblind, because in every family, one of my daughter is married to a gringo, born in New York, blue eyes, 100% gringo, and the other one is married to African, Cuban, and it's the same. We are all the same. And you find that everywhere. So that's kind of an interesting experience for anyone that goes to Cuba. Everybody laughs. We laugh for whatever thing. We make jokes about everything. So we take laugh just like that. And that's how, and that's why our ingenuity will never die. Because we try to find a good approach to everything. People sometimes are overwhelmed because it's tough, but you will see kids going to school every day with a clean uniform, shoes. Don't ask where they kept those, but they are like that. So you're going to enjoy it. You're going to bring also some hope. Because the fact that you're going there, you're from prestigious university, and that brings some hope. And I will try to help you in whatever you need to. So.
This is my American Express. I don't go to Cuba without her.
So I've been cleaning out my closet recently. Are we allowed to bring clothing and stuff like that for people?
Yes.
Okay.
I think you missed it earlier. We have a contact with the Catholic Church. And so.
Okay.
That's not going to be an issue bringing on the ship?
Yeah.
I don't know. There's no real luggage restrictions on this on a plane because it's pretty much whatever you can fit in your room.
Okay. The first time I went with Sylvia, we left all of our luggage in Cuba. This was 7 years ago.
We only wore back what we, on our back. And I was standing in line and going through immigration the first time. And the young man I was standing in line with, he says, "I'm sorry I'm so hot right now, but I'm wearing 3 or 4 layers of clothing." And then he pulled up his sleeve and he had 4 watches for his cousins. So, you know, it's, you're not going to a destitute place. These are, like Sylvia said, the people are, they're well fed somehow. I don't know how they do it. And they look good. And, you know, you've been to impoverished places. This is not that. It's very, it's not what, I expect the first time to see that. I didn't see that. But it's they don't have anything. And how they get by, who knows? But it's just incredible.
There's new places I've never seen before, but Alejandro knows them, where you can dance, where you can eat all kind of foods. What's the name of the place? That there's music from in the same place, different kind of music and food?
There's a lot of new bars and restaurants in Cuba with all these new
and they are safe.
Of the government.
Alejandro, what advice do you have for people who have not been to Cuba?
That you pretty much said it right there. Expect the unexpected. You've never seen and never will see anything like that. We have our own kind of reality, and it's pretty special. You're gonna have fun. It's pretty safe. They were really nice. Everyone's gonna try to help you. Almost everyone. Like, of course, there's that kind of people everywhere, but pretty much. Almost every people is going to be nice to you, is going to try to help you, and you're going to have a wonderful time.
Havana's a party town. I was there, I mentioned to the dean, and I go for early morning run down the Malecón. There's a beautiful causeway along the water, and I'm out there at 6:30 in the morning because we have to leave at 8 or something, and there's people still partying. They're not ready to go home yet. It was great, and they're having a good time, and they invited me for a drink. That's now on the way back.
Also, something that I've been finding, I was in Cuba like 10 months ago, and I was a part of a new generation that found this opening, and I was a computer science student there, and we were all this new kind of entrepreneurship with mobile applications, websites, and all that, and pretty much every time someone went there and had like a meeting with us, we met with Google engineers, with Facebook engineers. Everyone was like, "I'm impressed of what you're doing with how little you have. Take that part away. Never say that with how much, with how little you have. Just what you did, and that'll be enough." That's a good way to approach things. And if you come to a new business and you see them, I mean, it's working good, things are going well, never put that part. Never go beyond that, you're doing well, that'll be it. Never said, "No, you're doing well, despite you don't have this or that. You're doing well,
you can do
that'll
better.
Be enough."
Like this guy in the documentary, you can do better. Why don't you have 2 stores instead of 1? Come on, she's struggling to keep the one that she has and change her life, so.
The embassy wants you to have the mindset that you're their ambassador. You gotta think like that. We want to leave a nice impression, our university, that we're nice people, and we are nice people. But you're going to find them to be really nice people. It's a very rewarding experience.
That's the weather I mentioned. It's obviously something like Miami, but it's,
yeah, well,
December,
it's really
so
nice.
Well, December is going to be in the 80s, 70s and 80s, no?
70s.
70 at night, 80 at day.
What about rain?
Rain?
Not the rainy season now.
It's not going to rain too much.
Pretty much like Miami.
Well,
the
rains.
No, I see it everywhere.
But it's not like summer. It's not summer. You're going to love the cars. Have you got the part yet, what they call the taxi?
You don't get that much.
Yeah. Well, isn't it the
and regarding the ballet, the week that we're going to be there, the international jazz festival starts.
Okay. Is that cool?
Nice. Yeah.
This is so we planned this.
So it's very good, perhaps, and they start early, but they maybe the next day. So even after the ballet, if you want to go to the ballet, you can go there, and there's quite
question. When you say go to the ballet on, you're talking about Friday night after.
Friday night. Wait,
is it after dinner? Because it shows 5 o'clock.
Forget the dinner. We don't know.
Okay.
We're gonna, a lot of the stuff we're gonna change.
Okay.
This is kind of an outline.
So we'll have a night where we can, that night where we can actually explore.
You can, but if we go to the ballet first, then you go out afterwards.
Okay.
But if they want us to go to the ballet, then we gotta have to go, you know. Do I go to the ballet every Friday night? Of course not.
No,
my wife dragged me once in 5 years. But the Cuban ballet is supposed to be spectacular.
Well, Alicia Alonso is the name of the Cubans, how you call that, study? It's a culture of ballet, per se, Alicia Alonso. She used to dance at the New York City Ballet, so she's, and then she went to Russia, as Dr. Troyer said, and a lot of Russians went to Cuba, so that's a merge of two schools of ballet. But Alicia is well known now. They named the theater where the ballet is being played. Almost every, it's a season, it's not every day. And it's very pretty. So the building is very old, but it's refurbished from top to bottom. So it's a good place to be.
See, we talk about clothing. You need a bathing suit? I'm actually gonna bring, well, not really sleep, but goggles and a snorkel, just in case we have an outside chance of doing that. We have planned it, we have asked for it, but I'm not going to be there without it, just in case there's an opportunity, because the waters around there are just beautiful. And you can imagine, they're not, you know, they're pristine. The ocean's gorgeous. But be prepared, I'd love for us to be able to get to a beach. I don't know if we will. Probably won't.
Chelsea, I'm bringing something.
Go ahead.
But just in case, bring a fish. Yes? Please.
Oh, the ship leaving. Does the ship stay at port every night? Like,
oh,
what's
no.
the cutoff time to get back?
No, we give you the cutoff time. Yeah, in essence, whenever, like, the times that we have up on the, that literally the ship will be departing at 6 p.m.
So, like, when you say for Havana, 5 o'clock, get off the ship.
Whenever, Friday night is the only night you're in port, okay?
The ship's there.
Yeah.
Nice hotel.
So we can
come okay,
so
I guess
yeah, but
so
here's the,
night.
Here's the issue. They will typically, probably after midnight or so, it gets really sketchy with respect to getting through customs to get back onto the ship. Okay. And so I heard stories, it wasn't me, but I heard stories of folks whenever I was on the cruise this July, that, you know, people were trying to get back in at like 4 o'clock in the morning, and, you know, they had to wait until basically like 8 o'clock to effectively get back in. So be very careful and cognizant, you know, of that. You know, it's not
we'll talk to that before we land too.
Yeah. So you know, that may be a problem.
Yeah. And last question I have is regarding touching back to communication. I know, you know, we're not gonna have cell service, but something like WhatsApp could work. You need internet for that. So I'm just wondering, like, what if, yeah, with all these tentative things on the schedule?
Well, that's why we're meeting for breakfast every single morning.
Okay.
Breakfast will be where we disseminate what's happening specifically for the day.
So what if someone gets seasick and they're not able to make it? I'm just wondering, like, backup plan.
We just trouble for breakfast. So let's say you can't make breakfast,
no,
but you have room, right?
Yeah.
Right.
So will we know where everybody is? I mean, like, there's room.
Yes, we're going to have.
We will have all of that information and disseminate it.
And then you'll be able to reach Fred or I in a daytime. Okay, we just have to make sure.
Are we all on the same deck?
No.
We don't know yet. Let me tell you what we're hoping for. We just don't know. And we keep leaning on this vice president of sales to try to help us out here. But hopefully everybody gets upgraded, but we can't promise that. We don't know. You know, we just don't know. So it'd be nice to be on one deck, and they may end up doing that. But their communication is not their strong suit. And it's a new cruise line. They just started this in April. So this is new for them, too. And we're kind of the first, you know, one of the early people on it. And it's probably how we can kind of deal with it. So as we get closer, hopefully we'll know more and more. But then we may get there and not know any more we know now. And then we'll just all work it out. Yeah. It's going to be cool, whatever happens. Like I say, the worst case is everything falls apart in us. And then we go do our scavenger. and that'd be a lot of fun anyway. So we think the worst case is
that. Sounds good.
I like that idea.
Yeah, but we also, it'd be really neat to hear, every university has their specialties like we do in this country. It'd be kind of cool to hear what the economics professor from the University of Atlanta has to say about what's going on. I mean, I want to find out. So we're trying to do what we think is interesting and that also has to be educational. But we're going to have fun.
Okay.
What else?
Let me go back because you mentioned that we don't teach business in Cuba.
Business, they said they told us they did not have business classes in business.
Uh-huh. But there is the Ministry of Foreign Trade, and they have an institute, that's where I used to teach there. And they do teach foreign trade techniques and international finance, etc.
Oh, right. See, so, you didn't know that.
Mm-hmm. So, and that's mandatory not only for the people who work for the foreign trade, but for all kind of industries, any field of industry, the industries that import or export. So they don't do the import-export, but they have people in charge of what is needed, what raw materials, etc. they need. So that's...
One of the schools had a tourism department, and we asked to have a lecture of what's going on.
But it doesn't belong to the University of Havana.
I see.
There's a finance and accounting, etc., that belongs to the University of Havana.
So one thing that I totally forgot, if you have not already gotten onto the Havana website, okay, to input all of your details, please do that immediately, okay, because they need to have all that information prior, actually,
you know what he's talking about?
Yeah. But there's parts
they probably should have been sending you emails saying, hey, please log in and
has everybody done this?
Yes, with the exception
but
of
there
two
are parts,
and four.
There's parts we did not do.
Okay, and I was about to talk about that. So one of the things that you are asked to do is to file, I think it's like this affidavit of basically specifically what your intent is upon traveling to Cuba. The one that you are going to check is going to be educational.
And there'll be a number after that, and they'll ask you what the number is later on in the document. So kind of write that number down.
Yeah, but just make sure that you get that information entered as soon as you possibly can, because one of the things that you have to be aware of is they're using that information to forward to customs, okay? So you can't just, you know, like wait until the day before to enter that information. You need to enter it now, and chances are they'll be sending you several, you know, emails saying, you need the information, you need the information, you need the information. Please respond to that. Make sure you get all of that information taken care of so that there's no issues whatsoever with. And if there's anything that pops up that's problematic.
Oh, I'm sorry. Thanks so much.
Good to meet you. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Matt.
But if there is anything that should pop up that's problematic with, you know, any of the Fathom-related sort of things, let me know as soon as possible so that we can try to get anything sorted out. And if there's anything else, any other sort of questions? Yep.
Just on what you were just talking about, you on the video, you didn't say to select one of the numbers underneath. You just said to select the box that said education, and those other numbers underneath, you didn't have to check on.
Well, then you get to the end of it. When I did it, when I got to the end, they asked you what you selected. There was some kind of little thing I signed, and I filled that number in papers. Did you remember that?
Yeah, and the thing that particular form, they will allow you to modify that aboard the ship before we actually set foot in each city. So that one, it's great to go and get out of the way, but they will, like, just. What they'll do is they'll actually give a presentation on this and say, okay, if you check this box, you may not want to check that box because one of the things that you potentially have to do is if you were, because of all these restrictions, like for example, if you were to not be part of this group and you were to say, I want to get off the ship and do anything and everything that I want to do, you've actually got to keep a written record of what you did, where you did it, you know, all that sort of stuff to basically be submitted.
And your interviews, of course, are approved. So. So we had that.
Okay. All right, any other questions? Yep.
You asked us to bring our passports.
Oh, just in case, in terms of, I did not already have your information. You know, a couple of you, I don't, but.
Oh, let's cover that too, Fred.
Who Go ahead.
About the U.S. Embassy. We have one thing that we had real mixed emotions about. Fred and I have had a lot of quality time together working out some of these details. The U.S. Embassy will not allow us to bring anybody inside the embassy that's not a U.S. citizen. So we weren't sure, gee, is it fair to break off the group? So I'm not sure we told Sylvia, we're going to add, there's four or five of you who don't have U.S. passports. And you are going to go with Sylvia on a field trip. And it could be that you're going to do some business that, see, Sylvia knows some companies there. So you, it could be that that group's going to get some more surveys.
I want to find you to go to the No, it's okay. Yes.
Have you been in the embassy?
Yeah.
Okay, so Sylvia's going to take you, she had notes.
They gave me the visa.
Oh, that's right, of course. So anyway, so you're going to, if you're not, and we felt bad. We didn't want to break the group up in the same token. We didn't want the rest of the group to miss that. And they're being, I mean, I can't speak for the U.S. Embassy. And it took us, how many emails?
A dozen.
To get us in this deal. And when we went with the dean, he and I met with them, and they said, we really want to meet with your students. It's very important to us. And then when the ship changed their schedule, they only had these briefings Mondays and Wednesdays, and we're getting there Friday morning. We don't do Fridays. So we waited. You're the ones who told us we had to do this, and now you're saying you can't do it? Come on, you can't help us here. So we went back and forth. So we are going to the embassy, but you have to have a U.S. passport to get in. So I apologize now. I feel bad about it, but we'll do something cool with that group.
Thank you.
Actually, I've never been. It was
when it was the interest. Oh, that's right. Well, you know what? Maybe if you want to go,
it's fine.
There's a way to find another, as long as they have somebody speak Spanish in that group, and maybe we have somebody.
Okay.
So we'll see how that works out. You may get drafted.
There's a mention here about one nice outfit. Is it needed for the embassy or for the presentation?
No, we're really concerned about the ballet.
Is that like, three-piece suit or what are we talking?
We say business casual.
Okay. So attire for the presentation is.
Yeah, we just decided. Alejandro said we can wear anything we want. No t-shirts. The Fred and I will be wearing slacks to the universities. I kind of expect the president will be in slacks, but if you guys wear, nice dress shorts, that's okay. But there's no, on the ship, it's totally casual. We don't care what you want on the ship. You can come to our classes in shorts and t-shirt, we could care less.
Even for dinners and a lot of times cruises.
It's pretty casual on this particular ship. They don't have, or at least I don't recall them having like even the formal night, where it's
right.
Literally completely dressed up. It's pretty casual.
Yeah, I'm going to be jeans.
And then there are obviously local places to eat on board the ship, so that if you're the sort of burger and fries kind of person, you can get that. If you want the buffet, you can get that. Or if you want a traditional sit-down meal, you can get that. And then if you want to go to the nth degree, then they also have, for a surcharge of I think it's like $25, then you can have steak and wine and whatever else. It's like a premium restaurant on board the ship.
What else?
One last question. I just wanted to clarify what is expected of us as far as presentation and assignments. So just wanted to go through the list. So prior to getting on the ship, the book review and the presentation materials are due. And then
we said the book review before you get off the ship. We're okay.
Before you get off the ship?
Yeah, we'd like to have it early, but okay.
Okay.
That's fine. I mean, my suspicion is they're going to...
Wait, I'm sorry. I got that backwards.
Yeah, I'm confused.
I'm sorry. Book review before you go, because once you read the book...
Okay.
I'm sorry. Excuse me. Book review. You're right. Sorry.
Okay.
It's the rest of the presentation stuff. Did you go into blogging and all that? You're going to turn it before.
And blogging, and then the last thing is the scavenger hunt, possibly. So those four things.
So the book review is the only thing before you leave.
But regardless, those four things are academically what is expected.
All right. The book review and the presentation should be done before you get on the ship. Okay.
Because we need to do the upload.
Right.
Okay.
The blog. You will be obviously updating the information, not necessarily making it live, aboard the ship, but until we get to probably the last day, and then like I said, I'll reserve some internet time and you can upload everything from your jump drive.
Okay.
And then the scavenger hunt, what you'll be given, basically
we're gonna give you the sheets of paper to fill out.
We're giving you the sheets of paper, a clipboard, and send you out there and you'll just turn that information in and to what extent you may want to use bits and pieces of that in your blog, that would be ideal.
Okay.
So those are the only four academic
credits
required?
Correct.
For the whole deal. No tests, no finals, no midterms. Listen, our operations students have done this interview domestically, and it's one of the highlights of the course, because they learn so much about what's going on in the real business.
Book review, presentation, blog.
All right, any questions? Nothing else? Good question. Thank you. Thank you.
Are we going to have, like, how are you guys going to meet the U.S. Embassy and stuff, and we're going to meet local businesses? Are we going to meet, like, government officials from Cuba?
We're going to try not to.
Not to?
Well, I've been through that. It's just a propaganda deal that, you know, I mean, I'm sorry, I don't know, I don't offend anybody, but we're going to try to avoid that, and we may have, here's what's going to happen. Should have said that so quickly. The government's arranging our tours. My guess would be, now that you've asked the question, they're going to make sure that somebody can give us the propaganda speech.
Right.
So my guess is the answer is probably we will meet government officials, but we're not asking for it.
Like, for example, on board our bus, we will have, obviously, a driver as well as a Havana tour guide, and that guide, as is the driver, is there are employees of the government, and typically my experience was that, yes, you will get a lot of the information that they want to convey to you about those sorts of issues.
In the same token, I went at the trip that, you'll remember this, Sylvia, we were there seven, 8 years ago, a long time ago, and things were just starting there, and so our guide was, everything's relatively new, and the last day she broke down, tears, and said, did we offend you? She said, no, you didn't offend us, but you're so pissed. I was told you would not be. So I've been lied to.
Okay. You reminded me something about tips. Tips are not regulated as we do here, so feel comfortable. Do not accept anyone who's asking you, where is my tip? Because that's not the Cuban way, and that's not official or anything. So it's something that you're going to do because you want to, according to whatever you want to, but there's not
regulation. It could be in the bill if you go to a private bar or restaurant, but you can ask if it's in there. And my understanding is 10% is considered to be okay. And then what will happen to us, which we'll take care of, is our tour guide on the bus will expect to be tipped, and we'll handle that.
At the end.
Yeah.
Farewell.
Mm-hmm. Well, sometimes we get the bus for the one day.
Oh, yeah.
So we'll take care of it. Fred and I'll take care of it. Fred.
Is there a lot of travel time in the bus at each of these stops?
We don't know.
Not that much.
Not for where we're going to be going, there shouldn't be.
University is typically in the city. I have not been to the other two towns, so Havana.
The other two towns are much smaller.
Huh?
So the other two towns are much smaller.
Oh, yeah. University, when they dock the ship to the university, there's a lot of traffic. It can't be 20 minutes, can it? 15 minutes, 20 minutes. We walked from the Nacional Hotel there. Anybody?
Looking forward.
I'm sorry?
Looking forward.
Yeah, we are too. We're excited. It's going to be a lot of fun. And hopefully, this is our first annual. Now, Fred and I were talking about heading over to the
flight deck,
which is our bar here at the university.
Not required,
but buy you guys a beer if you want to. If not, you got to get back. You got a long ways to drive. That's
down.
Fine. Don't drink. Drink and drive bad. So, just warn.
Hey, if you're lying.
Fred's
lying.
I'm just.
I have to be a little bit. I could go tomorrow night. I just don't want to be. I start with breakfast at 8 o'clock this morning.
They're
great.
Are we going to have a good idea by the end of the trip, direction?
In your case, I would really worry.
I was with a client having a
drink. It's not pass fail. It's
ABC,
right. But,
right.
You know.
No, it's
great.
Yeah.
Yeah. Going over.
Anybody going over for a beer?
Yeah,
raise your hands real quick, just so I got a reasonable count of who expect. It's about 4 or 5 people.
We should know this track.
How I knew that.
So,
yeah.
How
do
I
accurate
is this
book?
Is it accurate in terms of?
We have no way of knowing. But I've been there a couple times. I think it's real.
No, I think it's very accurate. I mean, that seems to be
real. So basically, I should not go skiing with you because I'll probably die.
Oh, I'm an old guy. What's your major? Your role state? You better see this. Sue Rogers. Tom. On the ship, Tom. I chair the entrepreneurship real estate department.
Excellent holiday.
Time to school here.
What classes you taking?
So I'm taking, his money, one of my best friends.
Oh, how are you doing? That was our, now leave this recommendation, external access for recommendation.
Yeah, the only thing is.
Questions are very simple.
Hey, and one more with the lanyards, make sure that you bring your lanyards, okay, back on the strip.
This is where the trip's so secure now, right? I don't know all this stuff, but I haven't done it.
Are we following you?
It's like a competition.
Good. No, we're going to do, you're 20 to
but I've done it with part of
buy a couple of different rooms.
It was like.
Western Union?
Yeah, but I don't know.
I'm going to walk up and have one beer. But I got to go get it.
Obviously, pack up all the stuff and go over there.
I'm going to get that receipt, my US account.
Yes.
Bye.
Bring it in.
I don't know how. Where? Yeah, we are going to a Western Union.
There is a Western Union.
And I was like, maybe he's on the phone, but you're looking dead.
The whole thing was just, the whole thing was,
He'll change your dollars.
It's not the kind of trip that you want.
I talked to Miguel.
He's taking us somewhere.
Don't let you adjust it on the trip.
Now that's a